We're going to begin our discussion of the individual female reproductive organs with the ovaries. And as we discussed in a previous portion of the course, this is an example of a gonad. And the homologous structure in a male is referred to as the testes. And before I move into the specifics of the ovaries, I want to talk about the terms homology and analogy in biology. If you've read that the ovaries are homologous to the testes, then that is correct. If you've heard that the ovaries are analogous with the testes, that's incorrect. So let's talk about this real quickly. So for a homology, or homologous structures, mean that they were formed through similar embryonic tissue. And that's true. The ovaries and the testes are going to differentiate but have similar embryonic tissue. Whereas with analogous structures, they have a similar structure, a similar function, but they evolved separately. They're through different types of tissue. So if you think about butterfly wings and bat wings, those are analogous, whereas the ovaries and the testes are homologous, so developing through similar embryonic tissue. So I'll be using that term homologous to talk about structures or organs that are homologous between males and females. So moving on to some of the specifics in terms of the ovaries. And as we discussed previously, we have two ovaries very closely related to both the uterine tubes as well as the uterus. This is where you have the development of the oocytes. So very important in terms of gametes. Gametes are those haploid cells, and haploid meaning that you have 23 chromosomes. Also able in terms of to unite with another gamete in order to get the full suite of chromosomes. This is also an example of an endocrine gland because it's going to secrete sex hormones, and you'll talk about that more with Dr. Sullivan in the different part of this course. There are numerous ligaments associated with the ovaries as well as with the uterus, and we'll talk about each one in turn, but we're going to start with the broad ligament. And you can see really right here a nice image of the broad ligament. This is the uterus right here. This is the ovary right here. Now the broad ligament is a large complex. It's associated with the uterus. There's three main components of the broad ligament. But when we're talking about the ovaries, it's specifically the mesovarium, and that makes sense because you have this right here. So you know you're talking about the ovaries. The broad ligament is going to be peritoneal. So we do have peritoneum in this area. It's not going to completely encompass like we're talking about with the gastrointestinal system, but you do have a very close association with the ovaries and the peritoneum. We'll talk about it in a bit more detail. It's not completely encased or surrounded by peritoneum like we have with the uterine tubes. So that's the broad ligament. We'll come back to that in a lot more detail when we talk about the uterus. Also, I want to talk about the ligament of the ovary, or the ovarian ligament. And you can see that also right here. As you can see, this is the clear connection between the ovary and the uterus. So really helping to tether those two things together. Now, the ligament of the ovary with the round ligament are actually remnants of the gubernaculum. And that is a funny name. This is an embryonic structure that helped in terms of the descent of the ovaries from the lumbar region to its place in the pelvic cavity. So we'll talk about this in a bit more detail when we talk about the round ligament of the uterus as well. But these two together are the remnant of the gubernaculum. And the last one I want to discuss is what's referred to as the suspensory ligament of the ovary. And I don't really have a nice picture for you here, but what I do have, you can see, is this neurovasculature right here. And what is unique and important about the suspensory ligament is within this peritoneal lining, this is of the suspensory ligament. This is where that ovarian neurovasculature is going to travel. So very important in terms of really housing that neurovasculature. Now, if we remember back to our discussions in terms of arterial supply, the ovarian arteries are gonadal arteries. So gonadal arteries, we know, are direct branches from the abdominal aorta, similar to the testicular arteries. Okay, so now let's get down to the more minute or histological level. We're going to start with the outer level, which is the ovarian mesothelium. So this is going to be the outermost portion here. This is going to be continuous with the peritoneum. And this is what gives the ovaries that kind of grayish appearance that is very typical of the ovaries, which is very different than the glistening peritoneum that surrounds it. Now, after puberty, with the release of oocytes during menstruation, this particular portion of the histology, or the mesothelium, will become more scarred throughout time. So you have a very distinct difference between the surrounding peritoneum and the mesothelium. Deep to the mesothelium, you'll have the tunica albuginea. We know with the albu here, this means white, so very white in appearance. So really just a protective portion right there. The ovarian cortex is important in terms of ovarian follicles. And we'll talk about what those are in a moment, but important in terms of the release of those ovarian follicles. And the most internal portion of the ovaries is the medulla. The medulla is very distinct in the fact that it is highly vascular. You'll have lymphatics associated with the medulla, and this is the most internal structure of the ovaries. Now, in terms of the follicles, remember we said that these are going to be located in the cortex. And these are going to be oocytes in various stages of development. And when they are ready to be released, they're going to be maintained within mature follicles. So during menstruation, these will be released into, and this is really an important point, these will be released into the peritoneal cavity. It's not being released directly into the uterine tubes. It will be released kind of in this area. Now, it won't stay in the peritoneal cavity for very long before it's kind of swept into the uterine tubes. Now, one clinical thing that I want to discuss in terms of the ovaries are ovarian cysts. These are just fluid-filled sacs. They're either within the ovaries or on the outside of the ovaries. They're fairly common. Sometimes they're asymptomatic. Oftentimes they'll go away on their own. And most of the time they're non-cancerous. Typically, if they are cancerous, it's in individuals that are 40 years old or older. And some symptoms that go along with ovarian cysts: pain, pressure, pain during intercourse, changes in the menstrual cycle, specifically irregularity, sometimes pain in terms of that. So a fairly common thing that can occur, oftentimes it will go away on its own. In larger ovarian cysts, you might have to have some type of surgery to relieve the symptoms that go along with the cyst. So clinically, that's one of the more important things discussed with the ovaries. Now we're going to continue our discussion of the internal organs with the uterine tube.